talking a bit about what the app does and some of the challenges in pulling lots of different data from different sources. In this case, a lot of geoscience, kind of earth science data, which has been most of my background. So the original idea came from, as many of you have probably been up in an airplane looking out the window and just being awestruck by something weird you've seen out the window and wondering what that might be. And we live at a time now where there's lots of open data, there's lots of great technologies that allow potential to put something like Flyover Country together. And so I happened to be in the right place at the right time to start that adventure. So we put together an app that grabs information from these different sources, it saves it offline, and allows you to access it in airplane mode. If you're in a window seat, you can usually catch a GPS signal and then kind of track your progress and read articles and about things about the landscape or other different parts of the world below. Some of the natural history and things like that. So we've got about 260,000 downloads so far, so feel pretty proud about that. And yeah, I was gonna try a quick demo just to show it off here. So it's a worldwide app. You can use it anywhere on the earth because we're using global data sources so far, so that's been really nice. And there's a couple different ways that you can enter your path. So in flight mode, you can there's a road trip mode as well, or a hiking mode. But in flight mode, you can tap anywhere on the map and it'll kind of just connect the dots with a great circle. So we can just pretend that that's a flight path we're going to do. I'll hit load down here, and it's going to go out to kind of live right now. It's going out to different APIs from these different databases and asking, hey, what do you have in that polygon that we've kind of just drawn? And so as it loads, it zoomed us in there, and we've clustered that content on the map. So we've got things like dinosaur fossils and some little icons and critter things. Those are all tied to Wikipedia, and they're from the paleobiology database. We have different sources from Wikipedia. We have some volcanic data sets, so you can learn about the different volcanoes and other natural hazards that you're flying over, different things like that. So all kinds of landscape and natural history stuff. So then the key is that you can save it for offline, so you'd hit that same button again and you can choose what things you're interested in, downloads it all to your phone before you get on the plane, and now you can access that all while in airplane mode. So that's kind of the gist of the app. And I'm going to go into a few of the things that have been challenging in kind of synthesizing data from these many different resources and kind of requesting that data as well. So essentially, we have a path that we're trying to cover. And in this case, we've got like a two-leg flight. We're going from Minneapolis to Chicago and then over to DC. And we just need to get a strip of information for that. And so databases and API developers end up choosing a few different toolkits, and sometimes they'll use a standardized, like OGC kind of API endpoint with their like a web feature service or something. Other times they'll kind of do an ad hoc sort of thing. And in the geosciences, we found it's pretty common to go ad hoc with a lot of these API developers, and so they kind of make their own systems, and we kind of work to try to get the data from those systems. So a lot of times we find that folks have a bounding box option, and then you can see that in this case, we cover the whole flight path, but we've got data up into Montreal that we're going to be requesting, and you're probably not going to fly over Montreal in this flight, so that's a bit of it's going to waste some space when you're trying to save all that and be really efficient on your offline saving. So another solution is, we've used this on a couple data sources, is we're going to send a bunch of bounding boxes. And that works. We can get a little bit more centered around that path, a little bit more specific with it, but that also leads us to send the same request essentially multiple times, not so efficient. Similarly, point and radius is another thing we see. So Wikipedia's API, for example, lets you send a point, lets you specify some radius, and then ask for the stuff that's within that. But then you end up, if you're trying to cover a path like ours, you end up with a situation where you got a lot of overlapping data and you've got to clean that up. And we're doing this all client side, so it kind of gets challenging when you're on a phone just dealing with all of this and trying to keep it responsive and fast and good. So the ideal solution for us, and this is what we always look for if we're going to add a data source, is does it take a polygon? Can we send it whatever shape we want and it'll give us back the information within that? And so we've worked with a lot of different data providers, and it's been nice now that we have some download numbers. We can be like, hey, look, if you want to get your data into something that has a few users, add a polygon endpoint. And so that's been a really key challenge for us. It's just, and a really fun challenge, is working with all these different cool data providers to try to get some API endpoints that work well with us, and we think for other scientists too. So a watershed, for example, is not a bounding box kind of thing. You want to request data from within a watershed, you want to send them a polygon. So it's helpful for use cases outside of a fun little app. And then we get into the different ways that you might, the kind of query formats that you might be able to send. So WFS is a common one, and that allows you to specify a polygon fairly quickly. But again, we've run into a lot of other databases that have their own solutions that are also they work quite well. So we create something like this query with a bunch of cool names of critters from the paleobiology database, and send it a polygon at the end, and it returns the interesting cool critters that we want. So some of those dinosaurs you saw. So dealing with all these different data sources and pulling them down onto the client, we don't have a chance on kind of the server side to the way we've set it up so far to kind of deal with common cartographic issues where you've got like overlapping labels. And so in this case, we have a volcanic data set that has essentially the same coordinate as the Wikipedia article about that same volcano. We want both of those, but dealing with that is sometimes a challenge. So we've got a clustering. We use Mapbox's super clustering algorithm to cluster some of our points, and we're coloring them just based on the different sources. And so this is an area that I think I've been inspired by some of the NACIS presentations I've seen, and I think we can improve a lot of how we're doing this and in the future, and think about something more than just a circle icon, and maybe fossil icon for a fossil would be great, but doing that in a way that makes sense and is visually appealing and applicable across different situations is a challenge. Another thing is that all of these folks have many different data formats, and so we've kind of honed in on GeoJSON being a pretty simple standard format that we can just translate anything that comes down. We run it through filters on the phone itself and end up rendering it after we've transformed it to GeoJSON, and we save that GeoJSON as its own into the file system. We also need to take from these different data sources we have, we want to like connect some more interesting information. So if you're just given name Calcatherium, you don't know what most people, I didn't know what the heck that creature was, but we can use the different attributes to go out to secondary resources, so from Wikipedia, for example, to get the article about that creature and to go get an article about that time period. So what was the Miocene like? That's a whole different time period. And that allows you to, while you're encountering this fossil location, actually kind of put yourself into that position, that critter's life, when you're flying over. And then we also go out and get an image so you have some idea that this looks like a giant sloth kind of monster. Another thing I would love to add is like a human scale next to it, because this thing is actually like way taller than me. It's like a massive beast. So yeah, that kind of thing is cool. So some of the tech that we've used, this has been small team effort. So we're really lucky that the hybrid mobile app world exists. So we've used Ionic, and it's all web tech. It's HTML and JS, and that's made this possible. And so that's presented some challenges though with being able to cache this stuff offline. And so a lot of work has gone into that. So we use some Cordova plugins that allow us to access the native file system on iOS or Android. And we just essentially save all that content as you would a native app. And it's actually worked out pretty well. But if you run into a bug in Flyover Country, it's almost certainly something to do with the save process, because that gets pretty complicated as we're handling all of that and kind of in the background, interfacing between the native and the web sort of tech. So kind of mentioned that we were trying to commercialize this. This is kind of the one of the next steps for me after I've finished my master's now. There's still some funding from the NSF grant that started this thing, but we'd like to see it sustained and go on. And so getting it into the airplane in-flight entertainment systems, I think, is a really, really cool idea that could pull in a little bit of money to keep it going. And so maybe the seat backs are an interesting spot, but also just streaming over the Wi-Fi. Since it's a web app, it's really easy to just pull it up in a browser, and a lot more of those in-flight entertainment systems are moving in that direction. And so if anyone has some interesting contacts in the airline industry, I'd love to talk. But I've discovered NACIS last year through connections with Ross Thorne and Rob Roth at UW-Madison, and it's blown my mind. It's like an amazing, amazing conference, and I've just been inspired by, for example, the Washington Post example that was up yesterday in one of the talks, this fly over the Mexican border. I was like, that is like the visualization I need to create for Flyover Country. That's what we need to do. So super inspired by all you people here, and really appreciate you guys having the chance to do this thing. So thanks.